want freedom, we want rights. We are taking back the night.
Being involved in this year's Take Back the Night has been a great experience for me. I'm so thrilled to be sharing it with all of you tonight. I want to take a moment and look around. You are all here supporting the same mission, a campus and a community free of violence, and you are all here to support each other in that vision.
The power to end violence is in our hands. Take Back the Night is an exercise in that power. We are here tonight because we do not tolerate violence of any kind. We believe that our community can be violence-free. Each of you has a piece of paper, and on one side there is a leaflet. I would like to encourage everyone to join me in reciting this pledge to lead a violence-free life. Now, if everyone will read along with me.
I pledge to not be violent to myself, my friends, my family, my partner, or anyone else. I will stand up for other people and make peace.
Take Back the Night rallies began in Europe and the United States as a protest against the fear women encountered walking in the streets at night. The first U.S. Take Back the Night march took place in Philadelphia in 1975. In the U.S., as in Europe, Take Back the Night marches largely resulted from feminist activism against sexual violence against women. Activists from universities and women's studies programs across the U.S. developed the idea on college campuses across the nation.
Now, Take Back the Night is an international rally and march that is organized in local communities with the purpose of unifying those communities in a stand against violence. Our Take Back the Night is an annual event organized by the Northwest Coalition Against Violence in collaboration with the community and the campus. Can I please have Meghann Oliver, the CAF president, come up and tell us a bit more about CAF?
Hi guys, so our mission with Coalition Against Violence is to pretty much spread awareness about stopping violence for our campus and the community. Our meetings are every Thursday at 5 o'clock at University Wellness Services, that's behind Milliken Hall. And we just meet and we do lots of different things during the semester and during the year. I know in November we're going to the Women and Children's Shelter to volunteer there. We're also doing the No More campaign in the spring. So if you wanna come and join us, it's 5 o'clock on Thursdays.
Thanks, Meghann. We believe that our streets should be safe for anyone, regardless of status. We are going to use our bodies and our voices to show people our commitment to this cause. As we do so, let's remember the activists who came before us and those who will come after us as we participate in a long tradition of public action against violence.
One of the more successful outcomes of that activism was the Violence Against Women Act, which was published in 1994. Before the Violence Against Women Act, domestic abuse was considered a family matter and spousal rape was not considered a crime. In many states, they don't have domestic violence centers, rape crisis centers, or hotlines.
The Violence Against Women Act has no doubt saved lives and protected families across the nation. Practitioners in the criminal justice system better understand the complex responses needed to address domestic violence, sexual assault, spousal rape, dating violence, and stalking. Tonight, we invite you to commemorate with us the progress made as we work together to hold a war free of violence.
We'd like now to take a moment to pay our respects to those whose lives have been affected by violence, be they victims or families, friends or loved ones of victims. Let's take a moment of silence in their honor.
Thank you for taking the time to honor those who have been affected by violence. Your respect throughout the presentation and event tonight is greatly appreciated. And if you are disrespectful, you will be asked to leave.
At this time, we would like to join us in listening to the first of two survivor stories that will be shared this evening. Please join me in welcoming Sean.
Shawn Wake, but who I am is not important. Tonight, what's important is what I am. By that, I don't mean being a male. I mean I'm a survivor of domestic violence. There was a time when I thought myself as a victim of domestic violence, but that had such a pessimistic connotation that in order to turn things around, I was told to call myself a survivor. Let me give you a little background. Like so many people, I thought I'd found someone who cared about me, who loved me, and wanted to share things with me. I should have seen the trouble from early on in the relationship. But I was under the belief that what I now know is mental and emotional abuse was only temporary, that I somehow could fix it. As time went on, that type of behavior didn't stop. It wasn't long before it escalated to actual physical attacks. Again, I thought these were only temporary things that every couple went through. Plus, I believed I was strong enough to withstand it. It was not until much later that, and after several outbursts, that I realized I was slowly being broken down. Let me try to explain the cycle of abuse. A person may seem very sweet, very sincere, and make you feel that they love you and respect you. But if that personality starts to erode and change, and that person starts to try to control your life, you need to be aware of it. I missed the warning signs. I started to withdraw from my friends. I stopped doing the things that I'd always done. And people started mentioning that they didn't see me around much anymore and that I seemed distant. If your friends start asking you a lot if you are okay or if there's something wrong, I suggest you start to look around your life and find what has changed. Too often, abusive and controlling personalities will resort to physical violence. If that happens to you, walk away. The very first time it happens, walk away. The person who is trying to control you will do everything they can to get you back. They will apologize profusely and say that it will never happen again. Or they will start blaming you for making them do what they did. But I'm here to tell you that if a person cannot control their urge to hit you, they're not going to be able to control it the next time. You can't fix that mentality. So walk away. Otherwise, you're letting that person control you completely, and that is never a good situation. It just goes downhill from there. I was in that situation. I didn't walk away soon enough, and I regret it. It wasn't until a very dear friend told me flat out what she saw was going on in my life. Even then, I believed I could fix things. But thankfully, she persisted. And the next time I was physically attacked, I realized she was right. I went in search of what I could do to protect myself. And believe me, when I tell you there are a lot of things you can do, the most important of those things is that you can be protected by the law. If you are hit and in threat of great physical harm, get away and call the police. Thankfully, when I finally realized how much I was being abused and went to file a police report, I was referred to the Children and Family Center for additional help. It was amazing how safe I felt going to the center, and the help and when needed, and the continued support they gave me when things started getting considerably rougher. They were not judgmental and were able to help me figure out what I needed to do. There are times, even now, that I can still go there for reassurance. Looking back, I have absolutely no regrets of how I eventually handled the situation. Could I have struck back physically? Yes. But let me tell you that your real strength is not striking back, but standing up for yourself and walking away. Let the laws handle it. Rebuild your life. Surround yourself positive influences, and don't be afraid to ask for help. that is not a sign of weakness, but a true sign of strength. Also, if someone close to you points out something they see as a problem, by all means, listen to them and act on it right away. And don't worry about what other people might think. If I can paraphrase a quote, people that matter don't need an explanation. People that need an explanation don't matter. Listen. Get help. Walk away. Be a survivor, not a victim.
Called the Children and Family Center of Northwest Missouri. Rena is here from CFC of Northwest Missouri to give you more information about their organization.
Hi, I'm Rena from the Children and Family Center. I'm currently the administrative assistant. At the Children and Family Center, we provide safe, confidential, non-judgmental support and advocacy for victims of domestic violence and sexual assault. We have a 24-hour hotline that you can call. We respond to sexual assault, which you'll hear more about later. We have support groups for adults and teenagers called Wings and Image. We provide emotional support for court, help you with orders of protection, go to court with you for those, and other court advocacy. We provide personal advocacy for our victims. We provide shelter for all victims of domestic violence if they feel they need to come into shelter. We have a great volunteer and internship program that you may be interested in. You can learn what it's like to be a advocate at our shelter. Last year we served over 700 victims of violence. We currently have 3 victim advocates, 1 volunteer coordinator, 1 administrative assistant, 1 director, 3 on-call staff, and many volunteers that help us provide these services. So if you would like to contact us, feel free to do so. We are located here in Maryville. We also like to come out to the university and be a part of CAB. We've done that for 4 years. We also speak to university groups and organizations about how they can help the community. And if you have any questions, just give us a call.
We'd like to welcome B.K. Taylor. He's the health educator and advisor to the Coalition Against Violence, and he will share with us the importance of taking a stand against violence of all kinds.
I want to first start off by saying thank you. I want to say thank you to the survivors who are willing to share their stories tonight and the bravery that it takes to do that. I want to say thank you to Coalition Against Violence and the Children and Family Center, who is willing to help us create this event and really move it forwards. But the big thank you I also want to send is to you. You're the ones here looking at the change, wanting to make a difference, wanting to see things different. And that's worth thanking. Now I'm going to talk to you about my belief in how things can change, but the first thing I want to talk about is a little bit of a story. When I was a child, I faced a difficult path. I was raised in a family of violence. That was an aspect of my life. It wasn't until I was 15 years old and I left home that I realized that violence wasn't normal. Listen to that. I realized that violence wasn't normal. I didn't understand that. I couldn't imagine that this wasn't how people's lives were. Interestingly enough, I talked to a lot of people and I had this conversation about violence and why it occurs. And I found out that the violence that I experienced in my family and my home was not unknown. It was not a big secret or something that people didn't talk about. The community knew. But at the time, people didn't talk about it. It was a family matter. And that's where we come back to the thank you. Because that's what we gotta change. This is an extraordinary time. We face a truly extraordinary time. We can talk He for She or It's On Us or the No More Project. These are initiatives to challenge the culture we live in, to inspire us to do more. It's no longer a single person's problem. It's no longer the survivors who have to face this alone. It is on each and every one of us to take the initiative to do something about it. Now that can look in a lot of different ways, but I think it first starts by not being okay with the silence. By not looking around a situation saying, that situation looks bad, but I'm gonna walk by because it's not my problem. From this day on, the challenge that I present to all of you is that it is your problem. That we have to rise together, we have to gather together, we have to join as a team and fight against this huge issue that faces in front of us. We can't fix the problem if we refuse to look at it. We can't change the culture if we're not willing to challenge it. And that's what we're about here today. You have all taken the first step in challenging the problem, of challenging the culture and saying that it's never acceptable for a person to look at the wardrobe and say, maybe if I wouldn't have worn this, this wouldn't have happened to me. Maybe if I wouldn't have drank this, this wouldn't happen to me. Those are not acceptable questions. The questions we should be asking is, why did this person do this to me? And more importantly, who can I talk to get justice in this situation? They should be challenged. So as I kind of wrap up this conversation, I would love for you to look into He for She, or It's On Us, or the No More Projects. And as students, I'd love for you to get involved in the Coalition Against Violence and take an initiative to do something about it. But just you, each individual here, I hope that when you stumble across a situation, in a bar, in a dorm room, wherever it may be, that you'll be brave enough to ask the question, are you okay? And wait for a response. And when, no matter what you get, good, bad, or in between, you'll be willing to do something. I believe in all of us. I believe together we are the solution. Thank you.
Hate or bias motivated crimes, as this type of violence is occurring in our country. Northwest Missouri State University does not condone bias motivated incidents. The Vice President of Student Affairs and University Police requests that everyone report any bias motivated behavior witnessed or experienced. Now we'd like you to join us again in listening to the experiences of someone affected by violence. Please welcome Brandi.
I was 26 when I discovered that I was repeating the cycle of violence. It wasn't until the violence was brought on my daughter, when she was 1 and a half, and a phone call to the mental hotline, that I left the relationship I was in. This relationship was different. It was good that I was learning something new, or so I told myself. He would tell me and try to convince me that everything I had been taught my whole life was wrong. I needed to learn a new way of thinking. If I wanted to keep living the way I was living, I was going to continue to get assaulted because I didn't know any better, and he was going to teach me another way. He told me he would be there for me and help me through the process of relearning everything. By the time I had my daughter, it had been 4 years. I mentally got to the point I couldn't tell you even what I wanted to have for dinner. I was living in Las Vegas, and my ex and I had recently lost our jobs. We spent 2 weeks on the road on our way to Charlotte, North Carolina, where he knew people, but I didn't. After 2 months, we finally got an apartment, and his control continued. I was allowed to go to the thrift store, which was just down the road, and once he let me go to Big Lots, without our daughter, but calling me every 15 minutes, until I got home. He would tell me in such confidence, I'm keeping you safe, by monitoring the places I went, the people I talked to, down to the clothes I was allowed to wear. He did not want me talking to my family, my mother especially, because she was telling me this wasn't right. My mom had had enough and came out and told me that she thought I was in a cult and was extremely worried. So I got sneaky and I would hide in my closet, or I'd go outside in my car and talk on the phone when he would be asleep. She had convinced me once to leave him, because I just wasn't myself. And by this time, I knew that. I just wasn't for sure it was bad enough that I would need to leave. Till the first time he slapped our one and a half year old daughter across the face because she didn't do what he wanted her to. Then smacked her again because she started crying. I tried begging him to stop and telling him this was not the way to discipline a child. We needed to try time out. He didn't want to. His way was the only way, and if I wanted my daughter to do what I said, I would have to do the same. I was floored. I couldn't believe that he was saying. I knew this was wrong. As a young girl, my mother would tell me stories of when she was younger, how my father used to beat her while I was still in diapers and watching from my playpen. I wasn't going to be in a relationship like that. I was scared. I knew I had to do something. With my mother's words running through my head, no one is going to take care of you but you, I found the strength to make my getaway plan. Most of our things still in boxes, and made it easy to sneak in a few more from time to time. He never noticed. One day, while driving my normal route to the thrift store, I see a U-Haul company, and I ask about prices. Never writing anything down, no evidence of what I was up to. I late night phone call to my mother, discussing the day I was going to leave and go back home. November 19th, because I was going to be there on the 23rd for my mother's birthday. It was the morning of the 19th, and I had convinced him to let me go, or to let me take him to work, and telling him I had a bad dream, and that something bad was going to happen. With him being a little paranoid about driving anyway, I used this to my advantage. I had 6 hours. I packed mine and my daughter's things into both cars. I asked for help from a stranger to get my car on Car Dolly. And with my then 2-year-old in the back seat, we were on our way back to Missouri. You're probably wondering how this could ever gotten to this point. Everything I told him in confidence used against me. By knowing the secrets of my dark past, I started out telling him about my troubled youth. And as I trusted him more, my closet started to open, and I began telling him about almost getting raped in a local club's bathroom by 2 bouncers who no longer worked there. These were guys that I knew even outside the bar. They asked me to try their drink. I drank it. Not even 5 minutes later, I'm being forced backwards into the boys' bathroom with one of them pulling my pants down. Oftentimes, we blame the victims, like she was wearing a short skirt or maybe a low-cut blouse. Men and children are also raped, and the question, what were they wearing, is never asked. Basing a crime solely on what a person is wearing is completely irrelevant. That night at the club, I was wearing jeans and a t-shirt. This was not my first experience with attempted rape. My first, I was 17, at a house where I was living. My roommates decide to have a party. I have on my pajamas. Long story short, 4 guys decide to jump me in the kitchen with about 15 other people in the next room. I have never held onto my pants so hard in my life trying to keep them on. Society makes us ask ourselves, what did I do wrong? What could I have done to prevent this from happening? Women are given a never-ending list of rules to abide by to have our humanity respected. We are taught from the time we are little girls to fear men's attacks if we do something wrong. I got told stories of domestic violence, was never taught what I need to do if it ever happened to me. It was hard to see because it's not always black or white, and because that's just the way it was. Max was right. I didn't need to learn a new way of thinking. I was not going to be labeled a victim because I am a survivor. I set boundaries with people now, and I have found myself again to help others who have had similar experiences, and to be a great mom to my now 7-year-old and 1-year-old daughters. I have come to realize I am strong and powerful. I may not have the power to change my past, but my future is bright. I am speaking today to give my daughters a fighting chance. The cycle started before me with my mother and my grandmother, and probably before her, but I'll be damned if I don't stop it and let it continue with my children.
important to note that we are also here in association with the Sexual Assault Response Team, or SARC. Meghann Kosman from the Children and Family Center is here to share more information about SARC with you.
Hey everyone, my name is Meghann and I am a court and victim advocate at the Children and Family Center here in Maryville. Our goal as part of this team is to help victims of sexual assault. And it doesn't just take one entity to do this. This is a collaboration in this community of people that consist of University Police, Sheriff's Department, Public Safety, Highway Patrol, the hospital nurse, the university advocate, the university health educator, the Northwest counselors, the prosecuting attorney, and then the Children and Family Center. What a victim goes through, and as you guys have heard tonight, what a victim goes through is very, very long. It is very, very, the process is long. It is very, very difficult, and it is very, very emotionally draining. And our goal, last year, Missouri made changes in sexual assault laws that did seem minor, but in fact were really, really huge in ultimately going toward the goal of ending sexual assault. Those laws cannot get changed without people such as advocates at domestic violence shelters and sexual assault shelters, without teams such as the sexual assault response team, without law enforcement that works hard to fight the crime, prosecuting attorneys, lawyers, fighting the crime, making sure justice is met, and for volunteers and advocates and you all that show up and care. It comes from people who stop blaming the victim. It comes from people who want to make a change and care and know that violence does not discriminate against one gender. It does not discriminate against age. It does not discriminate against location or against anything, any other stereotype the society would have us believe. It can happen anywhere, and it does. So the ultimate goal of the Sexual Assault Response Team is to empower victims, is to support, to seek justice, and to see survivors through. So that is the Sexual Assault Response Team, and it's in the local community again, and so there's help for survivors, help for victims, and ultimately, hopefully, will lead to justice.
Now we would like you to join us again in listening to the experience of someone affected by violence. Meghann Oliver will share the poem of someone affected by sexual violence. Please welcome Meghann.
Take back the night. Take back the lives we naively gave to those who would use and abuse once they professed to love. Keep the promises we long ago made to ourselves. Take back the wombs, empty from birthing babies, who now bear their own seed. Fill the void with joy's glowing desires. Take back the arms that cradled cries, the hands that wiped tears. Fill them with subtle earth. Pound the yielding clay into powers born. Take back our thoughts, make them our own. Color them with simplicity's brilliance, let them soar like eagles on air swells. Take back the dawn, her golden light glowing on dreams' wildflower fields, red, yellow, and purple passion, swirling softly on breezes caress. Take back the night, its blackness echoing ancient fear, shine wisdom's luminous light into dark corners. Dance on moonbeams, swing wildly from the stars. Take back.
Let's take a moment to give another warm round of applause for the people willing to share their lives with us tonight. Rhonda from the Personal Development and Counseling Center here on campus would like to tell you a bit more about the services they offer.
Hello, it's my pleasure always to be here. And before I share some of my comments, I would like to introduce to you my wonderful staff. I don't know who I told you we were going to do introductions, but Courtney Polk is one of our counselors. She's one of our new staff people. Stacey Weaver's been with us for a little over a year now. Mike Maddock is here as well. You will not find a warmer, more caring, qualified group of people here to help students with a wide variety of issues here at Northwest. Would you mind giving them a hand? They will be handing our consistent messaging cards to you tonight, and these are not only wonderful resources for you to use if you're needing our services in personal development and counseling, which is part of wellness services on campus, but these would be wonderful resources for you to give to somebody who comes to you with a story, with a concern, needing your support. So please take one or two, we'll be passing them around. And if you need to talk to any one of us about your concerns for someone else or yourself, we're here for you. I wanted to just briefly, because I know we're all excited to get marching and getting the word out, right? I wanted to say to you that I think the power of stories is really significant. So not only as survivors, and we've heard some amazing stories tonight from survivors, I don't know about you, it really touches my heart deeply. I can feel myself welling up with tears a little bit when I hear those stories. They're really personally moving and important. But so many of you will be advocates, or maybe have been advocates, not only survivors, but I look out and see the warm, friendly faces, the bright eyes, the caring people who will be advocates, who will be there for somebody to listen to their story. But your story as an advocate is super important. If you will share why you're here tonight with one other person, how about two other people? If you'll share that, you can encourage someone to come forward with their story that they've kept inside. They haven't shared maybe with anyone about their shame, their fear, their pain. So I want you to remember tonight to share your story, why it's important that you're advocating for students. Maybe even you have your own personal story of being a survivor and of being courageous enough to come forward, okay? And then I wanted to share with you, how do you really address a survivor that comes forward to you and tells you their story? What do you say? I think if you'll tell that person they're courageous, that what they have to say is important, that you care about them. That is all you need to say to them, and the rest is going to come forward. Of course, you're going to then do something about it, right? You're going to help them get the services they need. You're going to help them get in touch with us. Our number is here. The statewide support number is here. It's a 24/7 hotline that anyone can call. I have it memorized. The 888 number, 279-8188, but it's right on here. The Child and Family Service number is on here as well. This is what you need to put in their hands when they're talking to you. But first, before you do anything, you just need to listen, tell them they're courageous, and that you're there for them. Do that, and the rest of it's going to be just fine. Of course, you don't have to tell them at that moment that it's just going to be fine. They probably don't feel like it's going to be fine. You just need to be there, support them, and help them walk the path that they're about to walk. And if you need any help ever, like you know someone is talking to you and you're not sure how to talk to them, you're not sure what to say to them, come and talk to us first. We meet with students on campus who don't know what to say and they're concerned about a friend. We'll help you find the words so that you can be there for the student and help them get the help they need. Again, I really want to thank you, and we'll be around tonight. Some of us will be marching with you, and if you have any questions or concerns, or if something was triggered for you, we're here to talk to you as well. Thanks again.
Thank you, Rhonda. CAF and the Take Back the Night Committee get help in the form of donations and attendance from numerous organizations in the community and on campus. We want to take some time to recognize them now. Our sponsors this year are University Wellness Services, Aramark Campus Dining, Bearcat Peer Education, University Police, the Sexual Assault Response Team, the Children and Family Center of Northwest Missouri. Let's give a warm round of applause and thanks to our sponsors.
Now I would like to have all the members of the Northwest Coalition Against Violence and the Take Back the Night Planning Committee join us up front. These dedicated individuals have spent the semester planning and publicizing our Take Back the Night rally and March Against Violence. Please give these people and our sponsors a round of applause for their commitment.
It is now time to get ready for the march. All of you should have a quarter sheet of paper. On one side of it, you will find the chants which we will be using. During the march, our volunteers will start the chants to make sure we are all on the same page. Please join us in chants throughout the march. Remember, the louder we are, the more people we reach.
All right, please prepare your glow sticks and we'll begin the march shortly. Please feel free to take any of these signs up front to carry with you while we walk around campus.
I got a feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. A feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. Tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. I feel it. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night.
Let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it.
Tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. A feeling. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. A feeling.
Tonight's the night.
Hey!
Let's live it up.
Let's live it up.
I got my money.
Hey,
let's spin it up.
Let's spin it up.
Go out and smash.